Thank you, sir. Commissioner Chandler, Commissioner Ferrello, and Commissioner Neal. If you can all raise your right hand, please. If you can all raise your right hand, please.
I swear you in. Do you affirm to tell the truth, the whole truth, and answer honestly to council members' questions?
I do.
I do.
Thank you, and you can begin.
Good afternoon, Chair Williams and members of the Housing and Buildings Committee. I am Rick Chandler, Commissioner of the New York City Department of Buildings. I'm joined by First Deputy Commissioner Thomas Ferriello, Deputy Commissioner of Finance and Administration Sharon Neal, and other members of my senior staff. The department's role in supporting the city's economy cannot be overstated. By enforcing construction laws, we facilitate job creation, spur the development of affordable housing, and uphold high standards in energy efficiency while adhering to our principal mandate to promote the safety of everyone who lives, works, and builds in our city. I'm pleased to be here to discuss with you the department's fiscal year 2018 preliminary budget and how it not only allows us to provide critical services to protect the safety of the public and facilitate development, but also supports our bold initiative to transform the department. As you know, our Building One City plan is fundamentally reforming the department to enhance public and worksite safety, reduce wait times and delays, and modernize all aspects of the department to meet the needs of the largest and most complex city in America. The fiscal year 2018 preliminary budget allocates approximately $158 million in expense funds to the department. Of this, approximately $128.3 million are for personnel services, funding 1,587 budgeted employees, and $29.3 million are for other than personal services. The preliminary budget provides $1.7 million in additional funding for 21 new staff positions. This includes $1.3 million to fund 15 positions to enhance energy code enforcement as committed to in the administration's Built to Last initiative, and $400,000 to fund 6 positions to enhance plumbing gas inspections. The department is a revenue-producing agency. Offsetting the $158 million in expense funding in the preliminary budget, the revenue forecast for the department is approximately $248 million. Which does not include more than $45 million in fines collected each year resulting from department-issued violations adjudicated before the Environmental Control Board. Some highlights of fiscal year 2016 construction activity follows. 2,931 new building applications were filed with the department, a less than 2% decrease from the prior fiscal year. 90,192 alteration applications were filed with the department, a nearly 2% increase from the prior fiscal year. The department issued 109,277 initial construction permits, a 5% increase from the prior fiscal year. The department issued 52,244 permit renewals, a 17% increase from the prior fiscal year. Finally, an important sign of future new building activity is initial demolition permits. In fiscal year 2016, the department issued 1,922 demolition permits, a 2% increase from the prior fiscal year, which shows construction activity throughout the city has shown little sign of abating. The department's work is evident in the safe and lawful construction that can be seen on every corner of this city. Whether it be the construction of skyscrapers in the Hudson Yards, the Western Hemisphere's largest Ferris wheel in Staten Island, or homes that keep New York City affordable, my colleagues and I take enormous pride in facilitating much of the built environment around us. Our Building One City plan commits to using data analytics to measure performance and drive progress. With that in mind, the department has created an analytics and data science division led by a chief analytics officer. With the launch of DOB Now Inspections, we focused on building a performance management approach to our operations, including routine reporting and coaching on performance issues. The success of this effort led to a similar effort to review and provide feedback on performance in our borough offices. We are deeply focused on improving service levels while improving the quality of services we provide. As part of this process, I meet monthly with borough commissioners and other staff to discuss the levels of service we are providing to our customers. Where we see successes, we seek to replicate them in other areas of our operations. And where our targets are not being met, we understand why and take appropriate action. I'm quite pleased to share that through this process, the department has made significant progress in improving services to our customers, all while facing a scale of construction perhaps unparalleled in the city's history. Wait times for first plan review have shown tremendous improvement. The average number of days to complete first plan review for new building and major alteration applications are down to under 5 days in February, a 60% improvement when compared to the same month of the prior year. First reviews for minor alteration applications during the same period also decreased by 60% to just over 1 day. There is also significant improvement in the number of appointments with the plan examiner it takes to gain approval. The average number of appointments to approval for new building applications are down to 5 appointments in February, a 32% improvement when compared with the same month of the prior year. Number of appointments to approval for major alteration applications during the same period also decreased 32% to fewer than 4 appointments. Additionally, there has been significant improvement in wait times for development inspections. Wait times for inspections of general construction work are down to under 3 days in February, a 37% improvement when compared to the same month of the prior year. Wait times for elevator and boiler inspections have been reduced by more than half during the same period to fewer than 4 days, a service level not reached in the department's history. Our response to complaints has shown significant improvement from last year and continues to show monthly improvement in fiscal year 2017. Our response to priority A complaints improved by 22% in February when compared to the same month of the prior year. A complaints capture violating conditions that, if occurring, present an immediate threat to the public and include unsafe demolition, building instability, and improper egress. These complaints are responded to well within our 24-hour target. Our response to priority B complaints improved by 65% in February when compared to the same month of the prior year, down to 23 days, which is also a 21% improvement from January and well within our 40-day target. B complaints capture violating conditions that, if occurring, while serious, do not present an immediate threat to the public. These include excessive debris, cracked retaining walls, and tampering with posted notices. These gains can be attributed to the hard work of more inspectors using new technology that allows them to work more efficiently. It's also due in part to the work of our analytics and data science division. Their work refining our data and displaying it spatially has allowed resources to be more efficiently allocated in addressing priority B complaints and conducting enforcement sweeps. This division has also been engaged in expanding the department's emergency response capabilities by developing ways to incorporate geospatial technologies to support our emergency operations, including post-disaster assessment. With the support of the mayor and city council, the department continues to make significant investments in staffing and technology to quicken the pace of our reviews and provide the filing community with the guidance they seek in a consistent and transparent manner. The department has hired 83 inspectors and 122 technical staff, representing 85% of our Building One City target. I am pleased to inform you that our plan to expand our space at 280 Broadway, to create a new modern customer service area is on track for completion this fall. As you may recall, the department was assigned approximately 15,000 square feet last year at 55 Chambers Street in order to address space deficiencies and create a new customer service center. 6 central citywide service units, licensing, elevators, boilers, administrative enforcement, customer service, and limited alteration applications will be located in the new space, which will be accessed from the 280 Broadway entrance. By co-locating these customer service units into one location, it will lessen the vertical traffic to the upper floors, provide better customer service, and create opportunities to reconfigure vacated space. The department continues making headway on the long-term process of redesigning its online presence with a new public-facing web interface called DOB Now that will replace the antiquated Building Information System, or BIS, and seamlessly interface with our other technological initiatives. When completed, this new system will allow customers to conduct all transactions online, including filing applications, making payments, checking the status of their projects, and having virtual interactions with staff. Last summer, we launched DOB Now for plumbing and sprinkler applications. Since then, we've added standpipe applications and facade compliance filings. Mandating that all compliance filings for facades be filed through DOB Now represents a huge step forward for the industry and our staff. Having far greater clarity and access to data points about facades across the city, both individually and in the aggregate, provides a tremendous convenience for the filing community and, most importantly, contributes greatly to public safety. The department also launched the public portal for DOB Now. The public portal allows the public online access to information on filings submitted through DOB Now, and as it is expanded, will provide information in a far more integrated and user-friendly fashion than can currently be found in BIS. While DOB Now will certainly reduce in-person visits to the department, there will always be customers visiting us to conduct their business. In an effort to improve the experience of customers who visit any one of our offices, we recently launched a queuing tool at our customer service windows. This tool will ensure that all customers are treated fairly and provide transparency into wait times, transaction times, no-shows, and unprepared customers. Simply put, you cannot improve what you cannot measure. This tool allows us to hold ourselves accountable with regard to wait times and transaction times, and also allows us to hold customers accountable for pulling tickets only for themselves, for showing up with when their number is called, and to ensure that they are prepared when they come to the customer service window. Additionally, we recently launched an interactive voice recognition tool to serve those who call the department. This tool will allow us to quantify the number of calls we receive, the amount of time call takers need to resolve issues, and the amount of time callers have to wait before they are connected with call takers. Customers call the department with a number of highly specialized questions, and our responsiveness is vital to their customer service experience. Concerning our construction codes, the department is not only set to embark on its periodic revision of the city's construction codes, we're also moving forward with creating two entirely new codes. The department is beginning the next revision cycle of the city's construction codes with the opening of the application process for committee members. The construction codes in their current form, which include the building, plumbing, mechanical, and fuel gas codes, were adopted in 2008 and were comprehensively updated in 2014, with the intent that they be periodically updated to ensure our codes incorporate the latest technologies and national standards, along with local modifications to fit the city's dense urban environment. With this revision cycle, the department intends to update code requirements to those of the 2015 international codes. And we've been working to prepare documents for review by consensus-based committees. The department is requesting applications from members of the construction, real estate, labor, architectural and engineering community, and other interested stakeholders to serve on technical and advisory committees that will help develop and review amendments to the 2014 New York City construction codes. As always, we welcome the Council's participation in this effort. Those interested in participating can apply through the end of March. The department has already begun preparing proposed changes to the construction codes and is scheduled to commence committee review in September. For the chapter in the code that deals with construction site safety, we anticipate the committee work will begin in May. Following the Mayor's direction to simplify the codes to make compliance easier, the department has also kicked off a research effort with the goal of developing recommendations for a code to specifically address work on existing buildings. The construction codes primarily deal with new construction, and in the vast majority of buildings, it's often not possible to upgrade an existing building to comply with today's more modern standards. Currently, when performing construction in an existing building, one or all of a myriad of local and state codes need to be adhered to. The purpose of an existing building code is twofold. First, to promote repair, maintenance, and reuse of buildings by streamlining requirements and triggers for upgrades, including compliance with the latest safety requirements. Second, to improve ease of use by consolidating all the requirements in one place. Once the research is complete, the department plans to develop a first draft of the existing building code and present it to the construction codes committees for their review. Finally, to address the need for regulation on waterfront properties, the department is undertaking an effort to develop code requirements for waterfront structures. While current construction code and national code requirements address building construction generally, current regulations do not specifically address design and construction requirements for waterfront structures such as piers, wharves, and seawalls, which serve as the foundation for new building construction. In order to effectively address this gap in current requirements, the department will be working with industry experts to identify the various types of structures and their associated requirements to ensure the safety and resiliency of these structures. Once developed, these requirements will then be sent to the construction code committees for review and ultimately adopted into construction codes. In addition to developing the code requirements, The department will also be investigating the operational needs and business process necessary to adequately enforce construction requirements on the waterfront, with the goal of consolidating the waterfront filing and permitting requirements within the department. Currently, those filing for construction permits on waterfront properties are required to file with either DOB or the Department of Small Business Services, depending on whether the property is city-owned, being used in the furtherance of waterfront commerce, or based on the type of structure. Consolidating these filings within DOB would streamline compliance and enforcement. 6 weeks ago, I testified before this committee on a package of legislation that seeks to improve safety on construction sites. The department supports many of these proposals outlined in those bills and looks forward to further discussion with the council while we continue to explore new solutions, including enhanced required training for construction workers. In recent months, the department has implemented a number of initiatives to help reduce construction accidents throughout the city. The department has hired 140 new inspectors. The department has more than quadrupled penalties for the most common safety lapses at construction sites. These penalties are now $10,000 for each violation, with a maximum of $25,000 when certain aggravating factors are present. Given the preponderance of accidents that occur on sites of fewer than 10 stories, last August the department increased supervision on construction sites by requiring construction superintendents to be present at more sites under 10 stories. Construction superintendents are required to inspect all work daily and keep a detailed log of the conditions they observe. They are required to promptly correct any unsafe conditions and notify the department of any accidents. Due to this action, approximately 2,300 additional construction sites citywide are required to have this enhanced supervision. The department is more aggressive in its discipline of bad actors. We have significantly enhanced our information technology and data analytics capabilities, improving our ability to target resources where the greatest risk exists and to identify bad actors. Additionally, we work regularly with each of the district attorney offices and routinely make referrals of construction professionals who warrant criminal investigation. In 2016, we issued 56,289 violations, a 23% increase from 2013, and over $128 million in penalties. We are also issuing stop work orders at a higher rate. In 2016, we issued 8,840 stop work orders, a 37% increase since 2013. Stopping work for a period of time can result in a bigger monetary loss to a contractor than even the most significant penalties. We are also regularly seeking to suspend or revoke the licenses and registrations of professionals who work unsafely and put their lives and the lives of others at risk. In 2016, the department revoked or suspended the license of 11 individuals or corporations and has numerous cases in progress. Some notable cases include Kenneth Hart, the general contractor of record for Harco Construction. Following a fatality in April of 2015 at 919 9th Avenue in Manhattan, and resulting from our investigation that revealed a significant number of violations, Mr. Hart agreed to a suspension of his general contractor registration. Upon Harco's conviction last June of manslaughter, criminally negligent homicide, and reckless endangerment, the department has filed a case at oath to have his registration revoked, which is scheduled for trial later this month. Andrew Trombetis, the licensed master plumber involved in the 2nd Avenue gas explosion, had his license revoked last year. Following the March 2015 incident, we conducted an audit of Mr. Trombetis' work, resulting in the issuance of numerous violations, which formed the basis for our petition filed at oath. Following trial, the judge issued a report and recommendation, finding that Mr. Trombetis was negligent, incompetent, lacked knowledge of or disregard of applicable laws and rules, made materially false or misleading statements on documents filed with the department, and endangered public safety. Mr. Trombetis is also facing criminal charges. Maqsood Farooqi, a licensed engineer, falsified a facade report at 305 West End Avenue that had a facade collapse that caused the death of a two-year-old child. Our investigation revealed false statements on numerous other filings. Mr. Farooqi is now banned from filing with the department and has separately pleaded guilty to criminal charges. Additionally, the department has written to the State Department of Education requesting that they revoke his license. Concerning crane operations, the department has pending cases seeking to revoke the licenses of two individuals. This includes Brad Alicia, the master rigger responsible for rigging operations at 261 Madison Avenue. On May 31, 2015, a chiller weighing approximately 24,000 pounds plummeted to the street as it was being inserted into the 30th floor of the building. There's also a case pending against Kevin Riley, the hoist machine operator who operated the crane that collapsed at 60 Hudson Street on February 5th, 2016, that resulted in the death of one individual. The department conducts proactive enforcement sweeps in areas where significant construction is occurring or where there has been a spike in accidents. An example is in Williamsburg, where we inspected 348 locations, including every active construction site under 10 stories, new buildings, and major alterations. Our actions resulted in the issuance of 482 violations and 107 stop work orders. This includes the issuance of violations to 67 construction superintendents for failure to perform their duties. The department participates in the Tenant Harassment Prevention Task Force, a partnership between multiple city and state agencies in which cellar-to-roof inspections are performed, investigations identify bad actors, and enforcement is executed. Separately, the department partners with HPD in performing inspections. In determining where to focus our attention, we work with the Mayor's Office of Data Analytics to review a number of data points to determine where tenant harassment is likely to occur. Given that the data alone will not identify all instances of harassment, equally important is our work with numerous organizations and elected officials who provide us with locations to inspect. Over the past 15 months, the task force has inspected 2,383 locations, resulting in the issuance of 1,981 violations, 288 stop work orders, 36 partial vacate orders, and 3 full vacate orders. Resulting from our investigations, several owners have been referred to the State Attorney General's office and are in various stages of prosecution and settlement negotiations. Additionally, the department disciplines licenses who participate in the use of construction to harass tenants. This includes MD Ashraf Ali, a licensed engineer whose filing privileges were revoked for routinely providing false statements on filings submitted to the department, including that work was exempt from having to obtain a certificate of no harassment. As recently committed to this committee, the department now provides on its website accident data collected by OSHA. This additional transparency will provide a more complete picture of construction fatalities and will include an explanation as to why the department's accident data differs from OSHA's. During Construction Safety Week in May, the department will be hosting its annual Build Safe, Live Safe conference. Hundreds of construction professionals attend department-led seminars where they learn about the latest accident trends and best practices for improving safety. Department staff will also be distributing thousands of multilingual educational flyers at construction sites throughout the city as part of its Experience Is Not Enough campaign. The department is also targeting its outreach to the most vulnerable populations within the construction industry, namely workers on small buildings and day laborers. In partnership with day labor organizations, the department will be providing safety awareness seminars throughout the five boroughs on safe construction practices during scaffold and excavation work, two of the areas with the greatest risk. We welcome the council's participation in this outreach and will be following up with more information. The department is also seeking greater flexibility in hiring inspectors to meet the demands of construction surges like the one we are experiencing right now. For example, archaic provisions in the city charter impede the department's ability to hire the inspectors it needs to maximize our enforcement efforts. The charter essentially requires all of our inspectors to have a minimum of 5 years of construction experience. This requirement significantly hampers the department's ability to pull from the widest pool of otherwise available and qualified talent. Legislation has been introduced at the council to give the department the ability to consider licenses, education, and experience that are beyond what the charter requires, and I would appreciate the City Council's swift consideration of this legislation. While we are pleased with our progress thus far, there is more work still to be done. We thank the Council for its support and look forward to continuing our work together to improve the department for the benefit of all New Yorkers. Thank you for your attention and the opportunity to testify before you today. I welcome any questions that you may have.
Thank you, Commissioner, for your testimony. We're very pleased to hear of all the good things that are going on and the average days of going down in certain places and licenses, fines and things going up, which is a good thing for us. I really appreciate the work that's been put in. I did want to follow up on some of the cases, that the most egregious ones that you talked about. So Mr. Hart, well, first, you said Mr. Hart agreed to a suspension of his general contract and registration. Did he have to agree for that to happen? What would have happened if he didn't agree? Does he need to be sworn in?
I think I need to be sworn in.
Yeah. Okay, go ahead.
Do you affirm to tell the truth and respond honestly to council members' questions?
So as part of our efforts against bad actors, we go to the Office of Administrative Trials and Hearings. And at the time, we were able to extract a large penalty from HARCO, along with a suspension for a period of time. And when they came back to work, they were going to be allowed to come back to work with some additional oversight. Subsequent to that, when they pleaded guilty in criminal court, we are now taking the case against them to seek full revocation of their license.
So when you say he agreed to a suspension, that was like a settlement type thing?
Yes.
I see. Has he been sentenced?
Yes, they have been sentenced.
What was the result?
I don't have it with me. I can certainly get it for you.
And I have the same question for Mr. Faruqi, if I pronounce his name correctly. Maksud Faruqi says he pleaded guilty to criminal charges. Do we have a final disposition on what his sentence was?
He had no jail time. I believe it was community service.
So he had no jail time, and it was, what was it?
No jail time. I believe it was community service that he was sentenced to. I can also tell you that in the case of Mr. Faruqi, who was involved with 305 West End Avenue, we are separately, we've separately filed a criminal case against the ownership of that building.
Okay. I'd love to know what happens with that. But just so I'm clear, Ms. Faruqi falsified a report, caused the death of a 2-year-old child. He was found guilty, and there was no jail time?
No jail time.
Well, you said it was community service?
I believe so. We'd have to double check with the district attorney for you, but there was definitely no jail time.
The laws governing that, was that state, municipal, federal?
So there are several. There's the piece that's in our codes, which allow us to revoke his filing privileges, which is what we've done. Then there are the state education requirements, where they look at his actual licensing as a PE. And finally, there is the penal law, which the district attorneys enforce. And so they use that to bring their criminal charges against him in criminal court.
Were the existing penal codes strong enough to provide jail time, and they just chose not to? Or were the codes, or do we need strengthening of the laws?
So I'm not in a position to answer on behalf of the district attorney's office.
I mean, I'd like to know if there's anything the city council can do. It just seems, this seems like a slap on the wrist for the death of a 2-year-old child. And so I'm very concerned about that. So
thank you. We feel similarly. And of course, we partner with the district attorney's offices. We're very proud of that. And we try to provide any support that we can give them. And, you know, the licenses for these engineers are issued by the state, and we strongly encourage the state to act. Because Mr. Faruqi still has his license, and he can still practice as an engineer.
He still has
not
a license.
With my agency.
So, because the license is state, you're saying?
Correct.
So he has a license, he served no jail time, and the child is dead.
That's correct. Frustratingly so.
That, if I was an engineer, I guess that risk might make sense if nothing's going to happen to you. That's frustrating. So if there's anything we can do just on the law side, if we can do anything in the city, I'd love to know that. And perhaps we can reach out as a committee to our state reps to find out what's going on and why Mr. Faruqi in particular still has his license and why the laws weren't strong enough to give a stronger penalty. the case against Kevin Riley is still pending?
Correct.
And with Mr. Ali, there were no criminal charges that were put against him?
No, I'm not aware of any.
Why is that?
Again, I can't really answer that question, and we'd have to talk to the district attorney's office.
He also was wrote for providing false statements on submitting to the document, right?
Correct.
Doesn't seem that there's much penalty for filing false documents.
He can't file with us any longer. That's a big deal. He can't do business here in the city of New York.
Sure. Just to the committee, when we talk about Mr. Faruqi, I'd also like to talk about Mr. Ali. All right. Thank you for that. On the One City Built to Last, how much of this funding has been spent down since the launch of the initiative?
So far we've spent $37.2 million through the end of February against the combined fiscal year 16 and 17 allocation of $70.6 million.
Does the initiative include any positions or funding dedicated to ensuring construction safety at development sites?
Yes, so overall, through the Building One City, the department has been budgeted 48 inspector positions related to enforcement, including 17 construction inspector positions, 22 plumbing inspectors, 2 electrical inspectors, and 7 positions allocated to the BEST squad. So in addition, we've also been provided with additional staff for data analytics and administrative enforcement, which has improved our ability to target resources where the greatest risk exists and more effectively hold bad actors accountable.
Switching to construction site safety, obviously, you've mentioned a lot of things that have been going on, which are appreciative. I know we have a package of bills that we're trying to move forward with. Despite that and some other safety regulations, construction accidents causing serious or fatal injuries have increased. During fiscal 2017, DOB reported 246 construction-related injuries and 244 construction-related accidents, an increase of 21% and 35% respectively over the same reporting period in fiscal 2016. Do you know what accounts for the increases in injuries and accidents on construction sites?
Well, as I have testified before, and you and I have talked over numerous occasions, you know, the construction activity in the city really is occurring at an unprecedented rate. And in 2015, we saw 92 million square feet of new construction. By contrast, at the peak of the last boom, in 2008, we saw 65 million square feet of new construction. The increase in injuries is due in part to a significant increase in construction activity, but it's also due to increased reporting resulting from greater supervision by safety professionals now required by the department on thousands of construction sites. More safety monitors equals more safety-related reports. And many of these accidents are preventable, as we all know, and our investigators often find that construction injuries are caused by basic failures to follow existing safety rules.
So you believe that the accident rate is not increasing as much, but the reporting is?
Well, we don't have any hard data to prove that, but we absolutely know that our monitoring is much improved from the 2008 period. In fact, there was much fewer safety professionals on the job sites back then. And now with construction site safety managers, site safety coordinators, and now construction superintendents, we know that the reporting is significant.
So I know that there's been increased construction, and I know with that we'll have some accidents. I still believe there's more we can do. I'm not going to accept that rate has to continue. Do you have a plan to help reduce the figures, even if the reporting is better?
I agree, Chair. Mr. Chair, it's not acceptable. You're right. In January, as I testified, I'm committed to working with this council and others to do even more to support a culture of safety, which we believe completely. It's a culture of safety that we have to foster within the development community. In recent months, the department has implemented a number of initiatives to help reduce construction accidents throughout the city. We've hired 140 new inspectors. The department has more than quadrupled penalties, as noted earlier. The department's increased supervision by requiring construction superintendents. We have been more aggressive in disciplining the bad actors, as we've discussed. We're also issuing stop work orders at a higher rate. And also that has a very significant impact. We're now targeting our outreach to the most vulnerable populations within the industry, namely the workers on the small buildings and the day laborers. And as noted also, we're seeking greater flexibility in our hiring of inspectors, as we've talked about before. We'll have more to announce in the coming weeks, but we're looking at ways to significantly increase the level of safety training that's required before a worker ever sets foot on a construction site, and we're looking at the safety training required in the apprenticeship programs to serve as a guide for this effort. So we're looking very deeply into that right now.
Oh, thank you. I think those are all great things, and based on what you testify, I think it's the right direction. Obviously, more stop workers, more violations, not, you know, creating anything that isn't there, but actually observing what is there and taking appropriate action. If we assume that extra reporting has to do with some of it, at some point we can assume that it will then level off and go the other direction. So we're assuming that because you're doing all these things, hopefully this time next year, we'll see start to see a decrease because it would have leveled off in the reporting at some point.
I agree. You're right. This time next year, we're going to have a lot more data under our belt, and we should be able to make more apples-to-apples comparisons. I'm not sure we're really doing apples-to-apples right now when we look a couple years back.
Well, I can't guarantee if I'll be chair next year, but I will certainly make my way here to ask at least this question.
We always welcome your insight, and I've really appreciated these past few years, so thank you for that. Hope it continues.
What's the total number of current sites under construction citywide?
I'm sorry, the number of what?
The number of current sites under construction citywide.
It's approximately 40,000 active sites right now.
Thank you. Now going to the permitting process. You've spoken about DOB now, which seems to be going well. What percentage of the total permits can be e-filed? What percentage of permits must be paper filed?
Most jobs can be filed through e-filing. Exceptions to that include full demolition applications, elevators, and limited alteration applications that require a sketch, among others. While applications filed through e-filing are filed electronically, the work that the department performs with the filing is not. DOB Now will allow every step of the process to be performed online, including the back office functions and communications with applicants. So that's the very significant difference between the two.
They can now, or they will be shortly?
We'll be with DOB Now that will allow every step of the process online, and including our communication with the applicants. So right now, e-filing is not that.
Okay, so when do you think that would happen? Oh, and when do you think DOB Now will be fully rolled out?
So DOB Now will eventually move 100% of our transactions online over multiple releases. To date, as you know, we've released the plumbing, sprinkler, standpipe, and the facade safety filings. It's required an incredible amount of planning, programming, training, and outreach. We're very proud of the progress we've made so far, and we're seeking significant improvements in staff and industry interactions. Each of these releases has underscored the immense complexity of the technical review and the needed communication between applicants and staff reviewing the filings. Simultaneously, we're working to replace our 27-year-old mainframe system. We're finalizing our procurement plans for the later phases, and we'll be able to provide more information about timelines releases in the future.
Do you have a time frame of when it'll be fully rolled out?
Not yet. It's years.
Okay. Like 2 years or 5 years?
We're going to say between the two.
Closer
to 2 years.
Closer to 2 years?
But that's pushing. It's proving to be extremely complex to replace a mainframe system. I think you've probably heard that before, but.
Sure.
But we're making progress.
Is the official answer between 2 and 5? Or is
yes.
The official answer 2?
Yes. No, it's between 2 and 5.
Okay. Will complaint and violation information also be on DOB Now, or will that remain on BIS?
No, the entire BIS system will be replaced, and so eventually that information will be, the information will always be there. It's just a matter of how it's presented. So that information will migrate to a different platform so that it will be viewable through the DOB Now portal.
In April 2016, the mayor signed into law intro number 831, which adjusted the cost for new developments and alterations for the first time since 1991 to reflect a more equitable fee structure. What impacts has this had on the permit filing process and revenue in the past year?
Well, I want to say thanks again for your support of the legislation that created a more equitable fee structure. The changing the fee structure has no impact on the permit filing process. The legislation is expected to have a net annual impact of $6 million. This includes $10 million in increased revenues from major development applications and $4 million of revenue loss from applications filed for 1 to 3 family homes.
Now to talk about inspections completed in 2016. In 2016, how many inspections were completed for electrical systems, construction work, plumbing, and gas work?
So currently, for fiscal year 16, there were 148, 162 for construction, 14,850 for plumbing, and 58,075 for electrical.
And did you say gas?
Gas is not broken out separate from plumbing, so gas would be included in the 14,850 number.
Okay. Is there any plans to disaggregate it, the gas?
We can do that. We just don't have that handy.
Okay, thank you. As of the fiscal 2018 preliminary plan, what is the associated headcount for inspectors for these categories?
So currently, for fiscal year 17, there are 63 positions allocated for electrical inspections, 274 for construction, and there are 70 for plumbing.
And do you think the resources are sufficient to carry out inspections, particularly given the record high rate of construction?
So currently, fortunately, we've been given sufficient resources to hire the staff to carry out the inspections. What's holding us back is the provisions in the charter to allow us to hire a larger pool of people to perform this work. So the department is seeking greater flexibility to hire inspectors to meet the demands if the construction surges, like the one that we're experiencing right now, through the legislation to change the city charter requirements. We think that this will provide us with greater flexibility to update the job specifications and allow us to consider other license types, education, and experience that the charter simply doesn't allow us to right now.
I know we're sounding a little broken record, Mr. Chair, but we're competing with a very, very robust construction industry, and it's hard to find that. We really need to expand our pool, talent pool.
Sure, and I've been supportive of it. My understanding is we're still negotiating what the actual final language of the bill
yes,
will be.
Yes, and gladly doing so. So we'll make sure that we wrap that up as soon as we can to your satisfaction.
Sure. Just a couple more questions. How did DOB decide which sites under 10 stories would have construction superintendents?
Thank you for your patience. We decided on I think your question, if I'm getting it right, is the 10 stories is when the site safety coordinator and manager triggers. So
yeah.
That's why we went under 10. And frankly, our experience in seeing these accidents were typically on the sides of those buildings that did not have a coordinator or a manager.
So the testimony in the testimony says department increased supervision on construction sites by requiring construction superintendents to be present on more sites under 10. So it led to believe that there either are or were some sites that don't have them. So how are we deciding? Is that right? Or help me understand that sentence.
Well, the construction superintendents can be on more than one site. If you're a manager or coordinator, you have to be on that site full time. What we allow in our rule is multiple sites, but you must visit each site daily. You must keep a log and record the actions that you observed and that work is being done according to approved plans, and you must verify that there is a competent person on site. And again, those are very important experiences that we've learned from these accident sites, is that frequently the job is left to a group of people where someone is not in charge, or no one's taking a lead act, or no one's acting as a lead. So that's what we think we're accomplishing with the construction superintendent. Not sure if that answered your question. Yeah, 1, 2, and 3 family homes do not have them.
Okay, so 1 to 3 family is a GC license, GC 1, 2, 3 license that's monitored by Consumer Affairs. So they already have their own monitors. 10 and up, we had a super, we had a site safety manager, so we had a lot of oversight on those. We're trying to fill the gap between the 3-story really and 10 stories, and that's where we were seeing all the incidents that were happening. Yeah, I think that's a fairer way to say it.
It's got to be a new building, a major alteration.
Yeah.
Alteration to raise.
Okay. Yeah. So on a very minor alteration that's on a larger building, we don't require the site super. So, for example, if you were doing an office renovation on a 10-story building, you know, it's not going to require the super on those. So if it's a major alteration, a major enlargement on the building, or it's a new building within that size, yes, you'll have a construction super on there. Yes, that's correct.
So it's a defined term in our code, and I do not have it memorized, but it's actually the definition from OSHA that we've put into our code.
Okay,
so
thank
it
you.
Is in our code. I'm sorry I can't recite it for you.
Okay, thank you. On proactive enforcement sweeps, how does DOB define significant construction or a spike in accidents, as was mentioned in the testimony?
I think with the testimony, when we said significant construction, I believe that we're referring to the alt ones in the new buildings or a full demolition. And then with our data, then we took the geographical area and found those alt ones in new buildings and demos and defined those number of sites and assigned our staff accordingly. If you were 10 stories or under, if you were under 10 stories.
Is there any ratio that you use to define significant construction?
No, it's not a defined term. I think okay. That was just a general term that we used, and I think I answered it before, I think.
And spike in accidents? How do you define where the spikes are?
Again, just using our data. So, sorry, there is no number to significant, it's not defined, but that's one of the things that we're doing with our more robust analytics capabilities. We're able to see any upticks in violations that we've already issued, or any reports of incidents or accidents that we're receiving from this, from the area, and then define a general geographic location. And in this case, this latest sweep that I've mentioned in our testimony happened to be happened to follow a very significant accident. It wasn't a fatality, but we noticed from that job site that we had been out to that job site before. We'd issued violations to that contractor before, and so we wanted to send a message. What we will frequently do is if we see that something unsafe occurred, we'll check our system to see where this contractor has other permits around the city, and we will go everywhere around the city and visit every one of their sites. That's one way for us to send the message that, that we're watching. And so that's something that we that happens on a regular basis.
Thank you, and I appreciate that there's flexibility needed in some of those things. So I won't drill further now, but it would be good to get a better understanding if a spike is two more than usual or three, or kind of what is the impetus to initiate some of the sweeps. You did mention some, which I think are good, but if there's any of, be great to understand that further.
Thank you. I think it's an iterative process and experience. I mean, the experts that I have surrounding me here have seen this, and they have excellent excellent instincts about where we should go.
Thank you. I have five questions from Councilmember Mendez, who had to leave, and I assured her I would ask her questions, so I'm going to get through them now. What is the cost associated with replacing BIS with DOB now?
You say it again, what is what?
What are the costs associated with replacing BIS?
So currently, the budget provided $30 million. Again, as the commissioner mentioned, we're currently evaluating what the level of effort will be in the future and are trying to formulate what that scope of work would be. So I can't give you a definitive answer at this time.
What, if any, changes will DOB now have in regards to landmark buildings and historic districts?
Wouldn't have any change. We currently have our systems connected to landmarks. That connection would be maintained.
What is the current headcount for DOB inspectors? What was it in FY16? And what is it anticipated for the out years?
So this fiscal year, the total number of inspectors that we have budgeted is 522. And next year, the number is actually going to be 506.
Will there be any increase in DOB inspectors for inspection of gas lines? There's a long wait time for inspection, and with recent gas tampering by owners, we may need more inspectors to same location.
I'm sorry, what was the last one?
There is a long wait time for inspection, and with recent gas tampering by owners, we may need more inspections to same location. I guess she's saying may need
to the same location.
Yeah.
So on the budget side, the preliminary plan did provide another 5 inspectors for plumbing gas inspections. In terms of the level of responsiveness, I'll defer to the commissioner to respond.
So I think I testified about our levels of service that we're quite proud of, but the plumbing inspection now is 3 to 5 days. Again, it's much, much improved from what it was in the past. Any gas inspection, if it's a gas inspection related to anything having to do with safety or a replacement of someone who had their gas shut off because of illegal construction or a leak, we prioritize that and get out there immediately. So that's something that we are very focused on.
What unit handles AHV after hour variance requests? How much revenue does DOB get from AHV permit applications?
Okay. Generally, the after our variance complaints are responded to by our emergency response team. And I'm. What was your other questions related to that? Money.
How much revenue does DOB get from AHV permit applications?
I actually don't have the revenue number, but we do know that we issued a total of 62,000, over 62,000 issued last year.
62,000 permit applications, I mean? For after
hour variances, yes. 62,000.
Wow.
Calendar year.
That's a lot.
Yes. 60,000 the prior year.
That is a lot. The councilman mentioned this has been one of the things she's been focused on, the after-hour variances. That does sound kind of high. Is that normally what we do? Have they been increasing?
So the initial after-hour variance, because the 60,000 includes all of the renewals. I'm sorry, I should have clarified that for you. So there's an initial permit, and then there are subsequent renewals if they do it in subsequent days and weeks following that. So in 2016, the initials on the after-hour variances was 18,000, which is consistent with the previous 4 years. So in fact, it's slightly less than it was in 2013. But there were significantly more renewals in the last couple of years, which ticked it up to the 60,000 number.
What are the reasons that folks have to do after hours?
So the permits are issued for a maximum of 14 days. So each time they want to go beyond that, they need to renew it. So that's how you go from 18,000 from that initial permit all the way up to 62,000, because it's a recurring thing that has to be renewed every 14 days max. So.
What's the initial reason why some folks can't need the variance to begin with?
Why they can't meet the variance?
No, why they would need the variance, why they can't do it within the normal hours.
Sure. The permit hours are from 7 a.m. to 6 p.m. And so so the after-hours variances are generally issued because it's safer to do it off the hours, so it's earlier or later or on the weekends, where, say, you were in Midtown, during the week there's a lot of commercial offices, there's a lot of traffic there, that'll be safer to do some of the work on the weekends. So that's probably one of the main reasons why it's issued.
All right. Thank you. I know that Councilman Mendez gets a lot of complaints about these, and if she was here, I'm sure she'd drill a little deeper. I did have one last question. Now, the Office of Special Enforcement, my understanding is you have three inspectors. Is that correct?
Three inspectors that are assigned to the mayor's office.
Do they participate in dealing with the B&B's inspections?
They do when the mayor's office chooses to follow up with a B&B complaint. That discretion is at that office.
The discretion is at that office.
Yes, their office is the one who, they're the ones who decide how to route the inspections.
I see. Just for the record, I've been one of the main proponents of dealing with the abuses of Airbnb in particular. It seems that though some folks are getting caught up in that, that we had no intention by any of our actions, and we made that clear. And so we're trying to help relieve some of those folks who are in particularly one and two family, maybe three family homes, who otherwise are legally using their home on these home shares, but there are some municipal laws that don't jive with what the state says and says in other parts of our municipal code. So it's a very big issue for folks, some constituents in my district, Carnegie District in particular, and others. So we're very concerned about those folks getting caught up. It's not something we intended, and we really want to push back on what we see as a problem with enforcement with those homeowners. I don't know if you want to comment on any of it. You don't have to. But
well, if you have a question, I mean, we have a few you know, bed and breakfasts are different than the online Airbnb type of situation. Not that they don't sometimes overlap, but there are different laws that apply here, and it's mostly related to whether the homeowner is going to be there and whether the homeowner will stay there. If the homeowner is not going to be there, then that's a problem. And I do believe that special enforcement has taken action against those folks, and I certainly empathize, and I totally agree with some of the issues that you've highlighted.
Sure. We do have some. I can't speak for all. I know in my district we have some where the homeowners actually live there and are still getting fined and very heavy. And so,
well, we'll be happy to work with you on that. Also talk to Christian at the mayor's office to see if we can reach an understanding.
Thank you very much. That's all the questions that I have. I really appreciate your time and your testimony. I think we're going to go straight into public testimony. This is everybody. So you want to call them all at once? We so far have 11 people signed up for public testimony. So if we can get one additional, I'm going to try to call 6 and 5. So if we can get two more chairs there. So that should make their way now. Caroline Aggie from Center for NYC Neighborhoods. Andrew Norris from Alec, New York. Cal Snyder, Palante. Beverly Pabon. And John Delfish. Right, that's 5, and we'll have one more. C. Daniel Dawson. So just again, we have, if they're still here, Caroline Nagy, CNYCN. Andrew Narcus, PE, Alec, New York. Cal Snyder, Palante. Beverly Pavone. John Delfish. And C. Daniel Dawson. And who else? So we do not have present Beverly Pabon. Oh, okay. John Delfish. Okay, you can sit. You can grab a seat.
Yeah, everyone have a seat, and then when you're asked to speak, just press the silver button.
See Daniel Dawson.
We have to leave.
Okay, so if we can get two more chairs. I'm going to call somebody else. Oh, that's fine. You're right. Yes, you'll be on the next panel. There will be a second panel. So we just need one more chair. So for clarity, we have Beverly Pabon, John Delfish, Carolyn Nagy, Andrew Narcus, and Cal Snyder. Is that correct? Can you each please raise your right hand?
Do you affirm to tell the truth and to answer honestly to council members' questions?
You each have 2 minutes to give your testimony. You can begin in the order of your preference.
Thank you. Cal Snyder, I'm speaking on behalf of Palante about HPD's ANCP program budget. I want to thank the chair and the committee. We have deep reservations about the budgetary impact of HPD's funding plan for the ANCP program, Affordable Neighborhood Cooperative Program, and we'll be providing a detailed report to the committee. As you know, ANCP was designed to rehouse the very low-income tenants in the remaining 150 TIL buildings under HPD administration. HPD has proposed a very risky plan for both monthly and long-term affordability for these co-ops. They are designed to house tenants who now pay in the $400 to $600 a month range, and in order to meet the projected monthly maintenance charges under ANCP of several thousand dollars a month, HPD is relying on Section 8 subsidies to bridge the difference. And from the testimony that we've heard earlier today, we know that that HUD's budget in Washington is under extreme pressure. Cuts of $37 billion are proposed for next year, and that includes Section 8. And we just believe it is irresponsible and highly risky to place these very low-income tenants in co-ops that are completely unaffordable without massive new federal subsidies in perpetuity. Reflect on the impact of federal cuts and their replacement by other city funding if these federal subsidies do not materialize. We're talking about millions and millions of dollars of monthly subsidies in perpetuity for 30 years. And HPD should not be creating a program without guaranteed funding to support these low-income tenants in the co-op housing to which they are going to be moved. And I thank the committee and Chair Williams for the opportunity to testify.
You can stay there if you'd like until everyone's finished.
Good afternoon. Is this on? My name is Caroline Nagy, and I'm the Deputy Director for Policy and Research at the Center for New York City Neighborhoods. Thank you, Chair Williams and the committee, for holding today's hearing on the preliminary budget. The Center for New York City Neighborhoods is a nonprofit that works to promote and preserve and protect affordable homeownership in New York so that working and middle-class families are able to build strong, thriving communities. Before discussing this year's budget, I'd like to acknowledge the City Council for your strong support of New York City homeowners. As a co-founder of the Center for New York City Neighborhoods, New York City Council has been a generous supporter of the Mortgage Foreclosure Prevention Program, which funds $1 million annually to the Center for New York City Neighborhoods, the vast majority of which is re-granted to nonprofit community-based organizations to provide foreclosure prevention, housing counseling, and legal services. We also have worked on a couple of really exciting initiatives over the last year, including the Community Restoration Program, which is buying distressed mortgages from the federal government. New York was the first city in the country to do so and was the first funder. New York City Council was the first funder and thought partner. I would basically like to focus on a couple issues with regards to affordable homeownership and foreclosure in the budget for this year. The most pressing issue is that the vast majority of foreclosure prevention funding in New York City, which is currently funded by the Attorney General through for bank settlements with financial institutions, will expire in end of September of this year. That's $9 million in foreclosure prevention services. That's set to expire. So it's a very giant chunk that would result in a lot of homeowners in New York City being cut off. We are currently working to get some of this funding replaced in the New York State budget with some success, but we would really appreciate working with the City Council and the administration on supporting our ask at the state. Thank you. I'll just say a few more words. We've also seen a very big rise in homeowner harassment, and especially with regards to communities that are seeing property values increase. These visits are annoying at best, but for seniors and homeowners who are in foreclosure, we've seen a very alarming increase in scams, particularly deed theft scams, as well as very bad reverse mortgages or other situations that are unsustainable for homeowners. So we have been working to expand outreach, basically making sure that New York City homeowners know that there's a place to go to get good help as opposed to scam artists who are basically pounding the pavement, knocking on people's doors. And so we're asking City Council and the de Blasio administration to help support further increased outreach to those ends.
Thank you.
Thank you. Here.
My name is John Delfish. I'm from 615 West 150th Street Tenant Association. I'm the president of the Tenant Association. And my concern here today is that in 1996, when we entered the TIL program, we were promised that HPD would renovate our building, move it, in the process they would move the tenants out to temporary relocation until the building is renovated. And in return, we will be able to purchase our apartments or unit for $250. Now, during that time from 1996, we've been running the building. We take tenants to courts, we do renovation, we collect rents. Well, we manage the building during that time. In 2008, HPD said that they had the money at the time to renovate the building. After relocating 15 tenants, the Bloomberg administration said that there were no money left in the budget. So we have tenants who've been in other buildings, in Teal buildings and AGFC buildings since 2008. And we were told several times, what we were being told was next year, next year, next year, and that just kept going on and on. In 2012, when we transferred to the ANCP program, they told us that the purchase of the renovated apartments will then be $2,500. In the building, we have a lot of senior citizens, including myself. I'm 80 years old. And the concern of the tenants is how would they be able to pay for the maintenance of the the maintenance for the apartments. On February 27th, we had a meeting with HPD and the developers. And what they are telling us now is that they will get a private developer who would get a loan from the bank, and they will renovate the buildings. And then what my concern is that we'll have to carry a mortgage for about 30 years. And with that, the maintenance will run anywhere between $800 or $1,200, and then there will be a yearly increase of 2%. And we are concerned now, how would the tenants on fixed income be able to pay for that that increase? We would also, we are also promised that, no.
Mr. Delfish, I'm going to have to ask you to give a closing statement, a closing sentence, please.
Okay. What my concern is, how would we be able to pay the high rents or maintenance in that case? They told us we will get Section 8 for those who cannot pay, but we are concerned about that. How long will HPD pay that the Section 8?
I don't have the answers to those questions. It's something, as I mentioned, that we will try to see if we can have a hearing on a later date. We have a lot of concerns, probably not more than you, because you're living it. So we're going to try to see if we can get some answers for you. We have to move on to the next person that testified. Did you say you were 80 years old?
Yep.
You look amazing. So if you can share your secrets or your diet, that would be fantastic. But thank you for your testimony.
Good afternoon, Chair Williams and members of the council.
Is the mic on?
Oh, I'm sorry. The American Council of Engineering Companies of New York, ACEC New York, is the voice of the professional engineering community, representing over 280 member firms throughout New York
State.
Can
you state your name, please, for the record?
My name is Andrew Naris. I represent the ACEC New York. ACEC New York represents over 280 member firms throughout New York State that collectively employ 24,000 people statewide, with a concentrated presence of firms located within the five boroughs of New York City. Of the total member firms, 50 are MWBE firms registered with the Department of Small Business Services. Our members are involved in all aspects of engineering for the public sector. We plan and design the structural, mechanical, electrical, civil, environmental, plumbing, fire protection and technology systems for the city's infrastructure, including transportation, energy, and wastewater treatment facilities, as well as for public buildings. Our members are also involved in a host of planning, resiliency, and environmental issues. Since its founding in 1921, ACEC New York has served as a source of ideas and a sounding board and a professional resource for state and city leaders, including the Department of Buildings. ACEC weighs in on many important issues of our day, from infrastructure investment, efficient energy policy, and alternative delivery systems to improving procurement practices. ACEC has volunteer code committees made up of professional members that work with the Department of Buildings, providing engineering expertise when developing code and policy for the city. ACEC has prepared a series of recommendations on improving the Department of Buildings and has been ACEC has prepared a series of recommendations on improving DOB that have been reviewed by the agency at the highest level and are being incorporated into a large extent in the agency's own reform efforts, which revolve around technology, transparency, integrity, and enhanced efficiency, and most importantly, safety. To that end, we fully support the funding for the departments of the modernization. We appreciate the work that you and the members of the council do to improve New York every day and look forward to continuing to work with you on these important issues. I thank you for the opportunity to speak before the board today. I'm happy to answer any questions.
Thank you.
Shalom, Chairman Williams and the council members of the Committee of Housing and Buildings. Good afternoon, and thank you for the opportunity of testifying this afternoon. My name is Beverly Pavone. I'm the Tenant Association President of 2 East 127th Street. I've been in the TIL building, has been in the TIL program since 1997. In beginning, I am here on behalf of my association, the TIL program, and the TIL Coalition, and part of Palante Harlem, to testify how essential it is for funding for the TIL buildings in its original form. We have been putting in our sweat equity and management of these buildings for over 20 years, and we was doing so on the promise that these buildings would be turned over to us as self-managing buildings for low-income families. Under the ANCP program, this will not be happening. Under the ANCP program, it's just a short-term path, actually, to gentrification and evictions and foreclosures for people of low income. So I'm asking the committee to set aside time for us to meet with you guys to have a resolve this issue of all the buildings of 158 or 60 so buildings that's in the TIL program, still waiting to be HDFCs and self-management under the program that we originally signed for. Right now, our building has been, like I said, in the program since 1997, and if the city is geared towards having home ownership for low income, this would be the best program. The city came to us when no one else wanted these buildings, and we did the work for it. We've been waiting patiently, and we want the promise to be still given to us because we did put in the work. We also would like to have a seat at the table when they make decisions about the TIL program, which they do not do. And we are the managers, and we've been managing these buildings for more than 20 years. And we have no input, but everyone is telling us what to do and what they're gonna do for us. We wanna be sitting at the table. And thank you very much for hearing my testimony.
Thank you very much for your testimony and for being here. For you and Mr. Delfish, are you displaced now, or are you actually in the building?
Actually, with Mr. Delfish, my building was also in the same program where we was going to be relocated. It was just literally a week before we got to move our first tenant out the building when HBD came to us and said, you know, everything is on hold. We have the money for your building because your building is already in the pipeline. Everything was there. We had our apartments. For the relocations, we had the keys to each apartment for all the tenants in our building, which was 22 at the time. Right now, one third of our building is vacant of deaths that people's been, you know, people died and some buildings with apartments was lost because we didn't have the right for successionship. Now we do, so we're able to keep what we have there, but we're not able to rent the apartments out to build our money back up. So right now, I don't have any building, any tenants in my building that has been displaced or relocated, and I'm happy for that, but I know of the other buildings who have, and that needs to be addressed also.
Mr. Delfish? Can you turn the microphone on, please?
Right, I'm still in my building, but there are 13 tenants that were relocated. Originally, there were 15, two passed away, unfortunately. They never get to see the completion of this program. Mm. Like Ms. Bobon said, we work as managers of the building, and we, so many promises were made. At one time, our roof was very bad, and HPD told us, okay, go ahead and get the roof repaired, and they would pay for it. When after the construction, you know, the renovation of the roof, they told us, okay, you have the money, pay for it, which we did at the time. At that time, we had over $600,000. Mm. But then they also told us, okay, you have money, now you have to pay for oil. We have a 60-unit building, and that's a lot of money we had to pay for the oil. So that depleted our funds. Right now, we're down to about $50,000, and we do not know how long that is going to take. Also, during that time, we had 9 tenants that were relocated to HDFC building, and each month we have to pay that rent for the relocated tenants. Mm-hmm. Their rent is about 5-6 times what we are paying currently in our building. Mm-hmm. So since that time, 2008 to now, we spent over $900,000+. I mean, HPD, because they're subsidizing the HDFC building. But we first, at the beginning of each month, we have to put out that money. That money is refunded to us in every 2 months. But that's a lot of money that, what happened, you know, with all this money, why they're subsidizing these HDFC buildings and we have to put that money out. That money could have been used to help to renovate our building.
And for anyone on the panel, why the concern that the new program is going to displace everyone as opposed to work the way they said it is, which is fulfill the program?
Well, under the program as it is now in the ANCP program, one of the things is that you have a 2% increase every year for people that's on fixed income. You have a mortgage, which we never had in the prior TIL program, which would bring down the rent a whole lot. So even though they have said that it's going to do subsidies for the maintenance fee, it's not going to work with the assessments that might come up on the building or to pay for the mortgage. You know, and another thing is that this was supposed to be a buildings within the communities of people of low income. The buildings, the vacancies that they have right now that HPD has been housing, first for under the TIL program for relocation of TIL tenants so their buildings can be fixed. Now they're going to use those apartments to be sold at market sales to bring down the debt of a mortgage. Now, what we see in our community now is that most of the HDFCs are selling apartments to people of these higher incomes, which defeats the plan of this being a low-income housing development. So within the 30 years that we have this mortgage, I can almost guarantee you that the people that's originally here is either going to be out because of foreclosure because they can't pay these things, or they're just going to be voted out or want to sell at a higher rent just, you know, just to get out. So you're going to lose these apartments and these buildings for home ownership to people of low income, and what the HDFC program was for.
All right. Thank you. Thank you very much, everyone who testified. I do want to make sure that we know which is the best advocacy group for TIL. to see if, as you mentioned, you can get a seat at the table and what that would look like. So someone can follow up with the committee who's the best advocacy group or groups to speak with to try to make sure that HPD is speaking to the right folks. So okay, thank you very much. We have six people for the last panel. One person was added. If you do want to testify, please make sure you see the Sergeant of Arms. If not, these will be the six and final people testifying. Luisa Rodriguez. Barry Weinberg. Is Barry Weinberg here? Benjamin Dolchin, NHD. Kathy Dang, Stabilize NYC. April Tyler, HDFC. And Lisa Mathis. So we're going to need another chair, please.
We're going to need two more chairs.
Why would we need two? Is there a translator? Is there a translator? April?
No, there isn't a translator.
So why do we need two more?
They're representatives.
Are they signed up to testify? Are they signed up to testify?
Well, we signed as a coalition.
No, if whoever's going to testify has to sign out individually. They have the opportunity to do that if they still want to. So we have Lisa Rodriguez, Barry Weinberg, Benjamin Dolchin, Kathy Dang, April Tyler, Lisa Mathis. Are there other people who want to testify? Or we need another chair.
I think there was one more from stabilizing.
Sorry?
One more from stabilizing.
They need to fill out a sign.
He did?
Yeah. What's the name?
Jonathan Hernandez.
I don't have it, so if you can fill out another one.
Just keep it on my desk and I'll get it.
Okay. What's your name, ma'am?
Rubia Tyler.
Rubia Tyler. Are you planning to testify? Needs to fill out.
She's almost 80 too.
Oh, great. You look fantastic as well. But unfortunately, you still need to fill out a form. So yeah. If you haven't filled out a form. Okay, so we have eight people going to testify. This is the last panel. If there's anybody who wants to testify, they have to sign up. Can everybody please raise their right hand? Do you affirm to tell the truth, the whole truth, and answer honestly the council member questions?
Yes.
Okay. You each have 2 minutes. You can begin in the order of your preference.
Good morning to everyone, and thank you for giving us the opportunity to testify. My name is Luisa Rodriguez. I'm from 615 West 150th Street, a TIL building now called ANCP. Our building has, as Mr. Delphi said before, our building entered the TIL program in 1996. In 2007, after waiting so many years for HPD to fulfill the promise, in 2007, at a meeting with HPD's Victor Hernandez, the then TIL program director, and Rufus Harvey, then building coordinator, Mr. Hernandez assured the building that they had the funds to do the rehabilitation. Consistent with that, they started moving people out of the building to do the relocation. That happened in 2008. I was one of the first tenants to be relocated. In 2008, now it is 2017, and all my belongings are still put in a warehouse that we don't even know where it is. We don't have access to it. I have been moved to a fourth floor, walk up. I'm 75. I guess they expect me to die to then have another vacant apartment in our building. And so far, they haven't done anything of what they had promised. Now they come up with what we have been talking about, this ANCP program, which we do not believe will be good for us, for the tenants. Maybe it will be good for HPD, but not for the tenants, because the tenants will not be allowed to pay whatever they want us to pay. Now they want the tenants pay for all the HPD's mistakes that they have done in managing this TIL program. They want to get a loan, they want us to have a mortgage, and to have a 2% increase every year. Many of us are on a fixed income, and we have a sweat equity in those buildings. We have been there for 20 years, sweating out, doing a lot of sacrifices, not having anything done, paint or anything, because we wanted the program to succeed, and we trusted HPD. We don't trust HPD anymore, and we don't want that ANCP program. So we need the committee here, we need the city council to really please examine this. What happened with that money that in 2008 they had?
I'm gonna have to ask you to give a closing sentence.
Yeah, the closing is, we need you to help us in finding money so that the city can fund the rehabilitation of the TIL buildings, not only of my building. I'm part of the coalition of TIL buildings.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Appreciate it.
Thank you. Good afternoon. Chair Williams, thank you for this opportunity to testify. My name is Benjamin Dolchin. I'm the director of the Association for Neighborhood and Housing Development. We are the umbrella organization of 101 neighborhood-based affordable housing and tenants' rights organizations across all five boroughs of the city. So I have more extensive written remarks that I'll submit to the committee. I'll just sort of emphasize a couple of the key points that I was going to make. You heard at length from the chair of HPD about, the commissioner of HPD, about the really dire threats that New York City is facing because of the Trump budget cuts. We know the details, but we know that a down payment on the cuts seems to be that $6.6 billion is going to be cut from the HUD budget. New York City receives a disproportionate amount of our support for our housing programs from HUD, and so New York City is facing both a human service crisis on housing issues at a scale that we haven't seen before, and also a fiscal crisis, because the tenants in NYCHA Section 8, who have been formerly served by CDBG, are going to be coming to the City Council, the City Hall, and to Albany to demand that their basic human needs be met. So in that context, it is more important than ever that we double down on our efforts to preserve the existing affordable housing stock. It is well understood that preserving the existing affordable housing stock is by far the most efficient way to preserve the affordable housing that New York City residents need and is the most cost-effective way to use city dollars. So in that context, we are asking that the City Council support the continued funding of the Community Housing Preservation Strategy, CHPS program, which is the combined programs formerly known as the Housing Preservation Initiative and the Community Consultant Contract. Together, these programs, with their funding last year, the organizations that they funded, last year alone, counseled over 15,000 tenants, educated over 28,000 residents, contacted over 66,000 New Yorkers, and directly helped to prevent the evictions of nearly 2,000 New York City residents. Recent HPD recent analysis by ANHD shows that on average in the last 2 years, the city spent $100,000 in direct city subsidy to finance each new affordable housing unit in the city's Housing New York plan, and $40,000 to finance each preservation unit. So unquestionably, the dollars that the city council puts into local activities to support the preservation of the existing housing stock is both more necessary than ever and more cost effective than ever. So in closing, I'd like to thank you for your past support of these programs and your past efforts with your community groups, and to ask that these programs be refunded.
Thank you.
Hello, my name is Barry Weinberg. I am a member of Manhattan Community Board 9's Housing, Zoning, and Land Use Committee. My testimony is not, however, speaking on behalf of the board. Thank you, Chairman Williams, for your time to address the committee. According to page 38 of the preliminary capital budget for fiscal year 2018, listed as Project HD1, the city has currently budgeted $63 million for reconstruction of residential buildings in the Department of Housing Preservation Development's Division of Property Disposition and Finance, including the Affordable Neighborhood Cooperative Program, ANCP. To date, $11.4 million of the $63 million has been spent. ANCP is a grave misuse of these funds that will saddle the tenants of the remaining 190 TIL buildings waiting to be cooperative owners with unsustainable debt burdens, and will commit the city to providing assistance to those owners using Section 8 money that is urgently needed elsewhere. Transfer of buildings to third parties via ANCP ought to be halted, and the city ought to rehabilitate the buildings through the tenant interim lease program and fulfill its commitment to its tenants to sell them their rehabilitated buildings at the cost of $250 for each apartment. The problems with ANCP are numerous. To begin, the program raises the price for tenants to purchase their apartments to $2,500, which many tenants do not have and cannot borrow. Second, and most importantly, instead of the city rehabilitating the buildings that they own per the TIL program, the city transfers the property to a third-party nonprofit, which then takes out a large loan to pay for the rehabilitation of the building, manages the rehabilitation, and then, if the tenants can afford the new $2,500 price level, leaves the new HDFC owners to contend with the massive construction loan. This creates both waste in terms of fees to the third party and also the opportunity for massive corruption in terms of inflated rehabilitation bills, kickbacks, and shoddy work being done by a construction firm and being overseen by a third party that are using borrowed money that will eventually be someone else's responsibility to pay off. It is a version of the home loan problems that plagued Wall Street in miniature. Earlier today in their testimony, HPD spoke of ANCP as a model to, quote, leverage private financing, unquote. I am afraid that this is code for offloading the city's promises and responsibilities under the TIL program onto low-income tenants via unsustainable debt. The city made a commitment to the tenants for whom it was their landlord. The commitment was that the city would rehabilitate their buildings and sell it to the tenants so they could become owners, gain equity in their homes, and preserve the communities in which they lived. ANCP betrays that commitment, and I urge the City Council to reconsider the use of capital budget funds to support that betrayal. Instead, those funds should be used by the city to rehabilitate the buildings directly through the TIL program. Thank you.
That was impressive.
Hello, everyone. Thank you to the Housing Committee for your time and the budget hearing. And thank you to Chair Giovanni Williams for prioritizing stabilizing NYC as initiative to as a key resistance tool for preservation of affordable housing in New York. I'm here on behalf of Stabilizing NYC, and we thank the committee for supporting us in the past with $1.25 million. We're here this year asking for $2.5 million to increase our work and have impact citywide. I'll give our story as CAV and then talk about our scale up and how we've had impact citywide. CAV, we organize rent-stabilized tenants in Chinatown. We also organize Asian immigrant tenants in Queensbridge. But for our work in Chinatown the last year alone, we've closed out two campaigns against SMA Equities and James Fong Inc., which was formerly owned by Meralda Properties. In one of those tenant buildings alone, we've won $205,000 in rent abatements, critical repairs and services for the tenants, and also, but what most importantly, is changes to the practices of these landlords so they're no longer purchasing buildings in Chinatown and doing the same thing all over the neighborhood. But when you look at citywide and the impact that we've had in the four boroughs that we're in, the Bronx, Brooklyn, Manhattan, and Queens. We've had 20,000 tenants attend tenant meetings. We've reached 4,500 apartments and had 3,235 leaders attend meetings. And these are all meetings that are being led directly by the tenants for their own will and their own determination. We've helped draft legislation around predatory equity and are coming out with research to help guide legislation to regulate predatory equity landlords. We are grateful that there was $40 million allocated for legal services, but what we find more important is organizing. We know one of our buildings in Ari Cohen, we settled the lawsuits, but we're at a point where the tenants want more, and the lawsuits haven't been able to actually give them what they want to ensure that they won't be forced out, and that's where organizing comes in. And that's why it's important to maintain the organizing funding for Stabilizing NYC. And then I think what I also want to emphasize that organizing is more than just lawsuits and rallies and protests. It's about follow-up. 90% of organizing is follow-up and getting a groundswell of people to feel ownership and to safeguard their own homes and communities. The last thing I'll say is that 100% of the people that we organize are working class. They're immigrants, undocumented, mixed status. They're African American, West Indian, Latino, Asian, South Asian, Jewish, white. And these are all people who are being attacked by the federal policies right now. So now more than ever, we need to protect our communities. And I won't doubt that Trump won't use his power to leverage his real estate interests in New York. Thank you.
Good afternoon, members of the Housing and Buildings Committee. My name is April Tyler. I'm here with Sylvia Tyler, and Blanca Vasquez had to go. She's a professor at Hunter College. But we are here representing the HDFC, or Housing Development Fund Corporation, Coalition Steering Committee. And I am also the co-chair of the Housing, Land Use, and Zoning Committee, of which Barry Weinberg is a member, of Community Board 9 in Manhattan. The HDFC Coalition began in 1992 as an effort to advocate for improvements in the policies of the City of New York towards HDFC cooperatives. In early 2016, we had to become much more active in response to efforts to modify existing regulations pertaining to HDFC buildings. HPD is proposing to prematurely sunset the damp tax abatement, which is afforded to damp HDFCs as early as next year, when it is not set to expire until 2029. They are further proposing to require HDFC cooperatives to sign a regulatory agreement that would essentially take control of our buildings from us, shareholders, and hand it over to a monitor paid for with our money, but controlled and beholden to HPD. We, the members of the HDFC Coalition, and hundreds of homeowners throughout the city who live in HDFCs, object. There have been numerous meetings throughout the city. Upper Manhattan, we had almost 500 people attend a meeting. In Central Harlem, over 200 people. In Central Brooklyn, 150 people. The Lower East Side, more than 200 people, et cetera, et cetera. All over the city, HDFC homeowners object. What we suggest that HPD do with, rather than misspend the money pursuing this ill-conceived notion of taking control of our buildings, is to, one, as people have spoken before, get the Till buildings out of Till and into cooperative ownership. Two, buildings that are in third-party transfer and languishing there for years, even decades in some instances, get those buildings into cooperative ownership. And also spend money, staff up to assist buildings that are in distress. Nearly 80% of the HDFC cooperatives are functioning well, doing well fiscally, doing well physically. The 20% that are not doing well, we need to develop programs to assist those buildings. I thank you for your time and attention.
Thank you.
And I have written comments that I will submit.
Turn it on. Hello, I'm with the HDFC Coalition Steering Committee. Everything that April explained to you, I concur and back up. I would like to give you a history of how the HDFC co-op that I live in, the experience that we had with HPD. Back in about 1989, they pushed us into the NHD, out of the TEL building program into HTFC prematurely. We didn't even meet their requirements, which one, number one, they wanted you to have $1,000 at least in a reserve fund per apartment. Now, we have 44 units. We had no such thing, but they said, oh, that's all right. They pushed us in. We had to get a lawyer to stop that, so they threw that sale out. But the next year, we did go into sale. So now HPD is making people languish in TIL. Back then, they pushed you into TIL prematurely. So they have not been consistent. And I don't know what their reasons are, but they have created a lot of problems. Now, as far as our building, we we have come out of the 60-40 lien, we called it. That is, if you make a sale, 40% of your sales go to HPD. Now, struggling HTFCs with minimum resources, if you do have sales, you need that money really for capital improvement. Now, when we went into the TIL program, they did absolutely nothing in apartments. My apartment, one apartment next door, April's, had a big hole in the floor. And so the only thing they did was the windows. And they, at that time, they claimed they would do two systems, like adequate wiring, rewiring, or adequate electricity. Now, our building is a double building. We have two elevators. So they claimed to, they were going, those were our two systems. They never really did that. But we managed to survive because Community Service Society helped us back then, thanks to April, because we owed back taxes and we owed a water bill. And if we paid $5,000 a month, it didn't hit the principal. It was only the interest, because they interest was compounded daily. So we were able to get out of that by Community Service Society loaning us the money to pay the back taxes and the water bill. And our building at this point...
I'm going to have to ask you to give a closing sentence.
Okay,
please.
At this point, our building is out of that lien. It's a solid building. We do not have a loan with the city, thank goodness, with HPD. HPD may need help. Then they would create more problems with their regulatory agreement because they're not acknowledging the vast variety and different types of buildings that are in HDFC at this point. So City Council should vote absolutely
Thank
no
you.
To the damp, removing the damp taxes.
Thank you, Ms. Tom.
Chairman Williams, council members, and staff, good afternoon, and thank you for the opportunity to testify. My name is Jonathan Hernandez, and I'm a staff attorney at Asian Americans for Equality, other known as AFI. For over 40 years, AFI has advocated for equal rights and access to vital community service for all New York City residents. To begin, I'm here on behalf of my organization and the Stabilizing Coalition to testify how essential Stabilizing NYC has been for the tenants that live in your respective boroughs. As the City Council deliberates the preliminary fiscal year budget, Stabilizing NYC is seeking $2.5 million to continue our work to combat tenant harassment and preserve affordable housing for New Yorkers who need it most. If the City Council is truly committed about safeguarding tenants from displacement and keeping New York City residents in their homes, it all starts with continuing to support Stabilizing NYC. During this fiscal year, AFI and fellow coalition members have been organizing all over the borough of Queens, from up and down Parsons Boulevard in Jamaica to Elmhurst Avenue in Elmhurst, and a great deal of apartments in between. AFI and community partners have knocked on 948 apartment units and engaged those tenants to speak out about predatory equity. For far too long, the landlords in New York City have had the major advantage against their tenants. Now with Stabilizing NYC, tenants have the ability to be on the offensive, bringing affirmative actions against their landlord. A major success we had as a Queens group this year came by starting a housing part action in Queens Housing Court.
Just last year, a certain realty group purchased 6 apartment buildings on the 150th block of 80th Avenue in Jamaica for $21.5 million. The landlord then began aggressively pushing rent-stabilized tenants and has allowed 21 Class C violations, 34 Class B violations, and 6 Class A open HPD violations on their premises. Among these violations, the landlord has not provided heat and hot water to their tenants. This has led to a high level of turnover in the buildings, which is a threshold of predatory equity that Stabilizing NYC organizes against. A collection of 35 tenants banded together to restore adequate heat and hot water that they rightfully deserve. Organizing is a fundamental component for our tenant engagement work. Stabilizing NYC enables us to reach out to many tenants in far-reaching areas in Queens that do not get enough attention. And frankly, if not for Stabilizing NYC, these areas in Queens would not be as organized to fight predatory equity. So I respectfully request that Stabilizing NYC funding see an increase in this year's budget to continue our work. And trust me, there is still a lot of work to do. Thank you for your time and consideration.
Thank you.
My name is Lisa Mathis. I'm from the 80 New York Avenue Tenants Association, a member building in the Crown Heights Tenant Union. I'm here to advocate for the passage of the 12 bills, stand for Tenant Safety Coalition, that legislative package that's set up to strengthen the DOB laws to stop tenant harassment. I personally am still suffering from the result of this. I live in an 8-family building. The new owners purchased the building in December of 2014. They harassed five of the tenants out, and 3 of us are still there. This is my second winter without heat because they illegally took the boiler out of the building. There are multiple violations at DOB. There are HPD violations. We're in court. We have a case in the building in Supreme Court. I have a harassment case in Supreme Court, Kings, and also I have a case in housing court. And because the laws are not strong enough to force them to have financial ramifications when they do this type of predatory behavior, my aunt, who has her own apartment, is now going through another winter 80-year-old woman without heat. So I'm here to just say that I think the 12 bills that are currently before the council would have stopped or at least given us some quick remedy to stop the landlord from doing this. Thank you for your time.
Thank you very much for the testimony. We did have a hearing on 7 of those bills. I don't know where they are in passage. Probably should speak to the sponsors of the bills and see where they are. I'm happy to assist in getting them passed. I think we should focus on those a little bit more than I think few people are. And then I think we're trying to plan to have the other 5 heard as well. But I've gotten a lot of social media attention about it, and I'm still confused of why folks are not focusing on trying to pass the 7 that we did hear, and I'm more focused on trying to hear the other 5.
I will follow up with you on that one. The folks do want to move that 7 to a vote. I just clarified with the folks at Cooper Square.
Okay. So I get the tweets, but I'm confused.
We'll email you.
All right. Thank you very much. Ms. Rodriguez, you said you have stuff in storage and you don't know where it is?
Yes.
I don't. Can you put the mic on, please?
I'm sorry. 15 families from my building, 615 West 150th, were moved out as when HPD started relocating tenants.
When were they moved out?
Now,
in 2008?
In 2008, yes. Because they say they had the money.
Yeah.
They had the budget. And that's how, consistent with that, they started moving us out. So they pay for our moving expenses. They paid to have our belongings in a warehouse, and they paid for the difference between what we pay, we the tenants that are out of the building.
Sure.
We pay our normal rent, our till rent.
I understand.
To our tenant association.
I want to focus on. You said they put your things in storage.
Yes.
Since 2008.
Yes.
What things are in storage?
What I'm sorry.
What kind of items are in storage?
everything that didn't fit in the small apartments where we went. We just moved with the barely necessities.
I'm also confused of why you don't know where they are.
They never told us, and they say that we cannot have access to that. If we have access.
Just so I want to clarify, you're saying HPD relocated you, put your things in storage since 2008, and have not told you where those things in storage are?
Yeah, no, they haven't.
That sounds mind-blowing to me. Is anybody from the administration still here?
I'm sorry,
who? So just to put on a record, hopefully they listen, we generally request that someone from the administration, someone from HPD and or DOB remain till the end of the hearing so that they can hear testimony from the public, which I think is very appropriate. So I'm disappointed, again, that there is nobody from the administration, no one from HPD or DOB here to take back complaints from the public. I want to get your name and information. Where do you live?
I'm relocated in an HDFC, actually, which is 484 Convent Avenue, apartment 41. My original building is 615 West 150th.
Do you know who your council member is?
I'm sorry?
Do you know who your council
member is? Mark Levin.
Mark Levin. Okay. Okay. Do you know her? Oh, yeah. I want to get your information. That doesn't sound right. And if that is right, I don't even know what to say about how somebody's thinking me in storage for almost 10 years and they don't know where it is. So yep. I definitely want to follow. There's other people who's...
Hundreds.
And you don't know where the things are? Can you come up? Come up.
Okay.
Can you come up? Come up.
So I keep this
one. I'm sorry.
State your name again.
I'm sorry, Chairman. Yes, hundreds of people. You want me to restate my name?
Yes, please.
Cal Snyder, representing Palante, the housing organization. Thank you for the opportunity to speak again. Yes, the answer to your question is hundreds of people housed in Till buildings and possibly elsewhere under HPD's administration have, at HPD's express direction, had the contents of their homes taken from them and moved into warehouses under the stipulation that the tenants whose possessions have been taken away have no right to know where their possessions were taken and have never been allowed to see them again. Wow. And this has been for 8 or 9 years in many cases.
And the tenants have requested to know where their belongings are and they've been denied? Is that?
Yes, they're not allowed to know where their possessions have been taken. And they've been living in in temporary arrangements, as Louisa testified. They've been moved from the apartments that they occupied under the pretense that the buildings would be renovated and they'd be allowed to come back and then their possessions would be returned to them. But now 8 or 9 years have passed, the buildings have never been renovated.
I understand that part. I'm flabbergasted about what you're saying now. This is unbelievable.
Well, it is unbelievable.
I'm hoping there is some explanation because this just doesn't sound, I don't even know what to say.
It seems not only implausible, but impossible. And yet it's been going on all of this
time. So I know the administration is generally listening to these hearings. I want to know immediately what's happening here. I don't even know what the word is. If this is really happening, I can't even fathom.
So Cal and Norm Siegel.
State your name, please.
Sorry, this is Barry Weinberg from Manhattan Community Board 9 again. Cal and Norm Siegel wrote an extensive report on these issues, among others, that can be found at www.palanteharlem.org/brokenpromisestil.pdf. And so the report is there for anyone who wishes to view it. This issue was featured extensively. And, you know, it would be stunning had there not been so many other stunning instances of problems that you would not think possible, but yet are, in fact, in reality, existing.
This just sounds criminal. So I really want to get to the bottom of this. Mr. Dolchin, I heard that the HPD testified. that, in fact, it doesn't seem that construction on housing has slowed down since 421A has been taken away. But I know you've done a lot of reports on 421A. What's your thought on that? I mean, it seems to me that it may not even be necessary, and definitely not necessary in the form that's been put forth. Is there a better use of what that money could go or can be used, direct subsidy? By your analysis, are you expecting there to be a slowdown without the continued ability to use 421A?
Yeah, so HPD is absolutely correct, and I was very pleased to hear them say that on the record because they've been a little bit unclear on their point of view on that. So this is something which is actually genuinely shocking to housing analysts, you know, my organization included. You know, it would sort of seem logical that if you are taking away a tax exemption, that there would be less development, because obviously a tax exemption is very much in the developer's favor. That is less likely to be true in neighborhoods where the market has been very, very strong and really hot market neighborhoods. We certainly thought it would be the case when 421A expired in January 1st, 2016. We certainly thought that would be the case in softer market outer borough neighborhoods. And we actually drew a red line, you know, on our map of the city where we thought that new market rate construction would really stop in its tracks because of the expiration of 421A. And this is a critical issue because this really is sort of the fundamental argument that both you know, the governor and Rebney and the trades have made, that unless you renew 421A, there's not going to be new rental development in wide swaths of the city. And that's sort of been, everyone knows it's not a good affordable housing program, but that was the fundamental argument, that new development would stop dead in its tracks. In fact, the exact opposite has been true, again, much to our surprise. In calendar year 2016, there were, and this is in the year after the expiration of 421A, there were 15,700 new units where there were permits issued by Department of Buildings for new units. If you look at the average of 2012, 2013, and 2014, there were exactly 15,680 on average units per year where there were new permits issued. It is clearly the case that in 2016, very quickly by the third and fourth quarter, that new construction permits for new units, particularly in the soft outer borough neighborhoods, returned to their historic averages. The implication here really is sort of twofold. One, that as we sort of see it now, 421A is not necessary to incentivize the market to build. But furthermore, if you look at the change in new construction land prices over the last year, what's happened, and I think this is sort of an important part of the explanation for why we've seen new construction return so quickly, it's that in the softer market outer boroughs, where land prices for new construction plots have been increasing by about 20% per year for the 6 years prior to 2016, suddenly on January 21st, 2016, when the law expired, new land prices leveled off dramatically, which makes new development much more cost effective. And that really is the explanation. So the clear implication is that, and we've suspected this for many years, that 421A is such an inefficient over-subsidy that it has the effect of juicing land prices, in effect making new development more expensive. And then sort of serves as an inefficient subsidy. So it is clearly the case that you know, you do not need 421A to incentivize new development in the markets where you would want it. Those arguments by Rebney are really quite specious. And on behalf of the taxpayers of New York City, I'd rather have what seem to be now about $3.1 billion per year, if you sort of look at the different implications of what the new, of what the Rebney trades proposals are. That money is desperately needed for city affordable housing programs. That money could be the core of a Section 8 voucher program funded by the city, exactly to fill in the hole that we're going to have from the federal budget cuts.
So 420A might have had the effect, you're saying, of artificially inflating land prices. The governor may be allowing his own Trump-like cuts for a program that at best wasn't used to produce affordable housing, at worst just simply isn't needed at all. Is that correct?
That is absolutely correct.
All right, thank you. Thank you very much, everyone, for the work that you're doing and for the tenants for providing their personal testimony here today. Ms. Rodriguez has something else to say?
In the mic. One line. The fact that no one from HPD stays, knowing that the public is going to say something, just shows that they don't really care about us.
Well, I'm very disappointed. I know the commissioner is new, so give a little slight pass there. DOB isn't, however, and I've had multiple conversations with the administration about keeping someone here just for times like this so they can hear exactly what's going on. So I, too, am disappointed that they're on here. I will say I'm really hoping what I heard is not true, that HPD can show something other than what was said here, that people's belongings are warehoused for almost 10 years and they have no access to it and don't even know where it is. That's just an absurd claim. So I hope there's some misunderstanding. I'm looking forward to hearing from them on that issue. Ms. Tyler.
So just a quick note, way back in the day when we were young, see Virginia Fields
still
when
young,
she was
you.
A, yeah, you're still young, I'm not anymore. See Virginia Fields when she was a city council member and Stanley Michaels flipped the script and let the public testify first. So that might be something that you want to consider for future hearings so that the agencies were able to hear from the public.
Well, depending on the topic, we do let some members of the public testify first. I don't know if that's definitely necessarily appropriate for this particular hearing. We have utilized it before. I do think it's appropriate for the administration to stay till the end of the hearing to hear the public. So, yes, Ms. Tyler.
Point. TIL program came because landlords, the city became owners of these slums, and the city was the largest slum lord because landlords didn't pay their taxes, so the city owned the building. So they developed programs to get the buildings back to life, and the people made these programs work. HPD was almost a handicap. They didn't really train. You had the training wasn't that done that well, and a lot of buildings, people in buildings managed to figure out ways to survive because that's their home. Where I live by City College used to be drug infested, garbage infested, everything. Empty stores, now it's a whole different ball game.
So, Ms. Tyler, I definitely agree. Actually, I used to stomp around Harlem School of the Arts, so I know that area very well. I do agree, not only this case, in many cases, there are communities that no one wanted to go into. In your case, particular buildings, they made those communities better. Now everybody wants to come into it, and they want to push out the people who put in the equity to be there. We're going to do everything we can to make sure that that doesn't happen as much as that's in our power. So I just want to say thank you very much for your testimony. Very much appreciated. For the record, New York Housing Conference put in a testimony as well, for the record. And with that, this hearing is now closed.